Good morning, everyone on YouTube land. This morning's scripture will be read by Sister Lynn.
Good morning, everyone. Our scripture today is taken from Matthew 14, verses 22 to 32. Let us hear the word of the Lord. Immediately, Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead of him to the other side while he dismissed the crowd. After he had dismissed them, he went up to a mountain to pray by himself. When evening came, he was there alone, but the boat was already a considerable distance from the land, buffeted by the waves because the wind was against it. During the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went out to them, walking on the lake. When the disciples saw him walking on the lake, they were terrified. "It's a ghost," they said, and cried out in fear. But Jesus immediately said to them, "Take courage, it is I, don't be afraid." "Lord, if it's you," Peter replied, "tell me to come to you on the water." "Come," he said. Then Peter got down out of the boat, walked on the water, and came toward Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid and began sinking. Cried out, "Lord, save me." Immediately, Jesus reached out his hand and caught him. "You of little faith," he said, "why did you doubt?" And when they climbed into the boat, the wind died down. May God add his blessing to this his word.
Thank you, Sister Lynn. Turn my laptop on.
Let's pray. Father God, we give this service to you. May your words speak to us deeply. May you place me behind the cross, you always in the forefront. In Jesus' name, amen. I had two titles to this and I couldn't pick one, so pick two. So in the bulletin, you'll see Step Out or Just Reach Out. I love this portion of scripture. When you get further into watching The Chosen, there's a tremendous episode, and they focus on this, and it's extremely deeply moving. There's a lot more going on in the background than just what we see of Peter's fear walking on water. I can't imagine walking on water. I don't think I would have done as well as Peter did. So have you ever had difficulty moving out with courage to do something bold and something new? Something that was positive yet scary. Something that could possibly change your life forever. This means stepping out of our comfort zones and allowing God to take over. This could be a relationship or a job or moving out of your comfortable chair and meeting new people. And if you did, what happened next? Was it something that did change your life forever? And did it cause you to want to praise God that you trusted him for the results? Well, it's scary sometimes. It's unnerving sometimes. And we're good at talking about faith, at least I talk a good talk sometimes, but I feel myself, I can be a little bit like Peter with his foot and mouth disease. He always meant well, mostly often, but then sometimes he'd speak first and think later. My father would sometimes say that to me. He'd say, "Christopher," after I said something stupid at the table that wasn't appropriate for the table, supper table discussion. He'd say, "Why is it that sometimes you speak first without thinking? You need to think first. And then if it's something worthwhile to talk about, then speak." So I took that close. At first I was offended. I was probably a preteen at the time. But it's resonated in my mind as an adult. It's wise to think that way. Many theologians believe that Peter had this nature of impulse. He often made decisions without thinking first. And you're going to see that in The Chosen as well. I guess I've been, like I say, a bit like that, like Peter. I always wanted to be such a faithful servant for Jesus. I'd start off with good intentions, and then when the going got tough, I might back off a bit or begin to doubt. I may not have denied Christ three times before the rooster crowed or run away and hide, but I may have denied his power for him to be able to do so much more in my life. I probably diverted away from God's plans at the time, and maybe if I had listened to God, things might have been a little bit easier. And then I've heard things like, well, when things get a bit stormy, doubt can gnaw the edges of my resolve and even sink me. My Lectio devotions that I use every day once asked this pertinent question about this piece of scripture. Where do we find ourselves in this story with the disciples and the boat? Where do we find ourselves as we step out trusting Jesus? Are we sometimes sinking? I want to reread a section of this only with the message. As soon as the meal was finished, he insisted that the disciples get in the boat, and then they go on ahead to the other side while he dismissed the crowd. And with the crowd dispersed, he climbed the mountain so that he could be by himself to pray. He stayed there alone late into the night. Meanwhile, the boat was far out to sea when the wind came up against them and they were battered by the waves. And at about 4 o'clock in the morning, Jesus came toward them walking on the water, and they were scared to death. "It's a ghost," they said, crying out in terror. But Jesus was quick to comfort them. "Courage, it's me, don't be afraid." And Peter, suddenly bold, said, "Master, if it's really you, call me out to the water." He said, "Come ahead." So jumping out of the boat, Peter walked on the water to Jesus. But when he looked down at the waves churning beneath his feet, he lost his nerve and he started to sink. He cried, "Master, save me." And Jesus didn't hesitate. He reached down and he grabbed his hand and he said, "Faint heart, what got into you?" The two of them climbed into the boat and the wind died down. Disciples in the boat, having watched the whole thing, began to worship Jesus, saying, "This is it. You are God's Son for sure." Now, when you read it in the message, doesn't it hit home a little bit deeper? It brings out this human, beautiful side of Jesus. He wasn't really in a way, he was kind of a scolding, but not in such a condescending, nasty way. He was showing Peter, "Just trust in me, even when I call you to do scary things." One commentary says, "I love how Jesus responds to doubt, not by distancing himself from Peter, but by reaching out and taking hold of him." And he doesn't make him wait. He comes immediately to Peter's aid. So do you remember one of my past sermons when it was called "When God Ran"? God doesn't hesitate to assist us in our doubt and in our pain and our crying out. He actually never leaves us. It's usually us who leave him. But he responds with such a deep devotion for our best outcome. Psalm 91:14 says, "Because he holds fast to me in love, I will deliver him. I will protect him because he knows my name." We have to know the name of the one that we called out to. We have to hold fast to Jesus. We have to hold to the hem of his garment, if that's the only resolve we have that particular day to muster up. We can call upon his name. He'll always rescue us because he loves us. And then when we realize that we are much the same as the disciples, Jesus will come to us if only we allow him to in our moments of need. William Barclay says in his commentary on this particular piece of scripture, says, "When the wind was contrary and life was a struggle, Jesus was there to help. No sooner had a need arisen when Jesus was there to help and save. In life, the wind is often harsh and negative. There are times when we are up against it, and life is a desperate struggle with ourselves, with our circumstances, with our temptations, with our sorrows, with all of our decision-making. At such a time, no one needs to struggle alone, for Jesus comes to save us across the storms of life. With his hand outstretched to save, with the love in his voice and comfort in his eyes, he calls us to himself for the refuge that only he can give. So remember Peter's foot and mouth disease? Barclay says something about that too. He says Peter was given to acting upon impulse without thinking about what he was doing. He acted without fully facing the situation and without counting the cost. First stating his loyalty to Jesus with one breath, then denying the Lord's name with another. Peter's whole trouble was that he was ruled by his heart. And however he might sometimes fail, though, his heart was always in the right place. The instinct of his heart was always love. But one thing to notice with Peter is, although he did suffer from impulse and foot and mouth disease, he always clung to Jesus. When he fell, he rose again. And it might have been true that even his failures brought him closer to the Lord. We must be aware of this in our own lives. We cannot let ourselves be driven so deep in our moments of failure, whatever that might represent in our life, to the point of never rising up again. We must be like Peter, hold close to the Lord, allow him to walk upon the waters of our life, and enter into the boat with us. Even though Peter was faint-hearted, Jesus built his church upon him. Knowing that deep inside, Peter did have the faith that was growing from the mustard seed perspective. It said that St. Francis of Sales, France, had noticed this custom of the countryside district that he used to live in. He often noticed a farm servant going across the farmyard to draw water at the well. And he also noticed that before she lifted the brimming pail of water, the girl always placed a piece of wood into it. So one day he went up to the girl and he asked her, "Why do you do that?" She looked surprised and answered as if it were a matter of course. "Why? Well, it's to keep the water from spilling, to keep it steady." Writing to a friend later on, the bishop told this story and he added, "So when your heart is distressed and agitated, put the cross into the center to keep it steady. In every time of storm and stress, the presence of Jesus and the love which flows from the cross bring peace and serenity and calm." I remember this old gospel song I used to sing many years ago when I was younger. It was called Master of the Wind. I don't know if you've... I think they used to sing it on the Gaither night, on the Friday night Gaither sing-song time. And the words go, "My boat of life sails on a troubled sea. Ever there's a wind in my sail. But I have a friend who watches over me. When the breeze turns into a gale, I know the master of the wind. I know the maker of the rain. He can calm the storm and make the sun shine again. I know the master of the wind." So this morning, is your boat sailing on a troubled sea? If so, you know what to do. You need to reach out to the Lord and cry out. Reach out and touch the hem of his garment and hold on for dear life. He will walk out on your waters of life and he will calm your sea. He will grasp your hand. He will pull you out. He's never that far from us. And all we have to do is just say his name, the beautiful name we saw on the screen, and he will answer. I think that moment that Peter was sinking into the sea under the rough waves, he must have cried out so loud with desperation. And with that cry, Jesus grasps his hands around Peter's hand, and when lifting him up out of the water with those loving and compassionate eyes, he showed his power, his strength, and he revealed, "All is well, my friend. All is well. Trust in me." I apologize for keep referencing music in my sermons. I have to do it one more time. I love music. I listen to the words, and I like to really respond to what songs say. They always have a message of some sort. I grew up as a Christian listening to a Christian band that all of us young people as Christians listened to, and they were called Petra. Petra was this famous Christian rock band way back when, and I think they're still around a little bit. Their name comes from the Greek word that Jesus gave to Peter, Petros, or Petra. Upon this rock, I will build my church. The song is called Just Reach Out. So sometimes the night seems to go on for days, when it's hard to see the light through the darkness and haze, while the world around you makes you feel out of place. The burdens that you carry are just too hard to face. Just reach out, and He'll reach in. He'll take your broken heart and make it whole again. It don't matter who you are or where you've been, just reach out, and He'll reach in. Standing in a crowd, but you still feel all alone. Crying out for answers, but nobody knows. Everybody's busy looking out for themselves. Is there anyone who really cares about anyone else? Just reach out, and He'll reach in. He'll take your broken heart, He'll make it whole again. It don't matter who you are or where you've been. Just reach out, and He'll reach in. You say you've walked 10,000 steps away, but don't you know that it's only one step back? Because the one who hears you when you pray is the one who's there beside you, and He'll never walk away. Powerful words. True words. It said, the miraculous feat of Jesus walking on the water, written in the three Gospels, come right after His beautiful teaching in the feeding of the 5,000, with only 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. But it was a revelation of Jesus walking on the water that more than ever convinced Jesus' disciples that He was the Son of God. And then Jesus demonstrated Himself to be in command of the natural elements, something only God can do. He showed this truth to the disciples who witnessed His divinity and then responded with a confession of faith in Jesus as God. And it says, when they got into the boat, the wind ceased, and those in the boat worshipped Him, saying, truly you are the Son of God. It doesn't matter where we start in our journey with Jesus, only that we continue on. As you continue with Jesus in life, always remember that He alone is the master of the wind and the sea. It is only through Him that we can truly live. And if we confess this as a child, He continues to walk with us. He continues to calm the waters and the storms. We have to remember that we can always come to Him with whatever we face, with whatever we feel we cannot handle. And He will pick us up and we can carry on. So today, let us allow Jesus to walk upon our seas, to enter into our boat of life and to journey with us. Amen. Our next hymn is Victory in Jesus. God bless everyone in YouTube land. Have a good week.